Welcome back to the Roll Up High Roller community. As always, nothing on the Roll Up is to be construed as financial advice. We are just some educators in the DeFi space. Toss us a quick like, give us a share, a repost, send it to a friend who may want to watch this, and finally, give us a sub or a follow. It means the world to help support credibly neutral educational content in DeFi. We're here to educate, empower, and enrich you. And let's jump in.
So, when did you start with Web3Auth?
Web3Auth specifically, I think 2019.
2019.
I was at the Ethereum Foundation as a researcher. Been doing that for about a year, and it was doing out of Singapore. So me and my co-founder back then, we always used to do different side projects. We were in the phase of coding where you kind of feel like academia is cool. So you kind of think like, oh my gosh, I totally want to read papers. I want to implement cryptographic schemes, you know. Ooh, it's so cool, you know. And so we had a lot of different types of projects that kind of spun out of it. There was one that did like ring signatures. I'm not sure if they're familiar.
A little bit.
Oh, nice. Okay. I'm really well versed.
So maybe you could give a high level like explanation. Because I did math in college, so I'm
fantastic.
So
I mean, ring signatures kind of are a
also Monero uses ring
signatures. They do for all transfers, and they use its designated verifier property. So in particular, what ring signatures are in concept are you have a whole bunch of you have a group of public keys which you can sign, which any one of them can sign a signature, where you don't know which public key actually signed. So for example, you could have, this can be used for like whistleblowing properties. You could like sign on behalf of the public keys of everybody on, let's say, the Tesla factory floor and say that, you know, production schedules aren't on track. And then you could theoretically sell that information as somebody who's on the Tesla public floor, right? And then, you know, it's like, yeah, so I mean, that was one of the projects. So we did quite a few of these different things. And Web3Auth started out as one of these different projects that and just basically caught the eye of a couple of people, and they're like, oh wow, it's back then, it was just a basic kind of like DKG.
What's a ZKG?
It's a distributed key generation.
Okay.
So it's just generating a key from multiple locations, such that none of these different locations know the key. I mean,
Part of the key. They don't have the full part.
They have part of the key and to a full key that they know definitely does exist.
Okay.
So DKGs are often used in a lot of the ZK ceremonies, actually, when generating some of the initial ZK proofs. They're one of the fundamental things to it. DKGs are also just a general cryptographic primitive. We in particular used it and we paired it up to a like social organ. Okay. So it kind of was a DKG set of, if you will, like nodes or instances that basically was like an oracle to your final public private key pair, which you can get by, let's say, Google Auth. So it's kind of like proxying or in a way. I mean, I think people were more attracted just to the Google aspect. They just saw, cryptographic jargon, blah, 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 but I get a Google login. Holy shit. And then they were like, yes, invest. That was back in 2019. So we started out as a wallet. It was called the Taurus wallet. I'm not sure if you're familiar. One of the, back then there were no other wallets that were competing with MetaMask. MetaMask was basically had dominance, and they also beat out like Mist.
Okay.
Mist used to be like a desktop native wallet. So they beat out Mist, and we had just come in, and dApps were just starting to become a thing. So we basically went around going like, hey, like nobody wants to install a Chrome extension. They just want to, you know, log in with Google into your app, use this Taurus wallet, right?
It was a
desktop or
it was a browser-based
browser wallet. Extension.
So it was a browser, not even an extension. It was a browser-based wallet.
Oh, okay.
So it's kind of like it existed with the domain security model, where a domain would basically be loaded in your website as an iframe, and then you would have kind of the PayPal-like flow when signing transactions. So when you'd click sign, you'd go out. Into there'll be a pop up or there'll be a redirect, and you'll have to sign and go back into the app. So, a lot of apps love that. And we did get quite a few integrations. We integrated with CryptoKitties back when it was just starting. We did, I don't know, let's see. When were you first in the space?
2016.
So,
I did not buy a CryptoKitty.
You film one? It was like a copy of Pokemon, but like,
I wasn't around there either, but like the Parody wallet, I was using my Ether wallet back then. No. And my Ether wallet was also a browser online wallet.
Yes.
Now, my Ether wallet, I could click create a wallet and it used username and password. So it knew my seed phrase and my private key.
Oh, was that Ether wallet? I thought Ether wallet, you click create wallet and it was just seed phrase. And it printed the seed phrase out to you. No? Maybe they have both.
I think you could, my Ether wallet, you could do username and password.
Okay.
Maybe it did both.
Yeah, I think it probably did both.
Yeah.
In particular. But yes, sure. The username and password would be, I'm not familiar with my Ether wallet's like username and password implementation in particular. But I think there was a different company that did that. Portis. You know Portis? They got acquired by Shapeshift.
Oh, Shapeshift, yes.
Yeah.
Maybe we go this way. It's a bit loud over there, I think.
Okay.
Yeah?
Oh, sure. So they acquired Shapeshift. And Shapeshift acquired them.
Okay.
So
in 2020, 2016, you were saying?
No, this was in 2019.
Okay.
This was 2019. We did that for about a year or two. Apps loved it, but people didn't really... apps loved it, but users... It might be like the timing of it, or it might be... I'm not sure for whatever reason, but we weren't seeing retention.
From the Taurus wallet.
Yes. So like... The Taurus wallet still exists today, by the way. You can still try it out and play around with it. It still has about 200K, 300K... once active users.
Wow.
Which is like a decent wallet.
And is there which are some of the more prominent applications that are using Taurus?
Rarible.
Okay.
You can connect with Wallet Connect to any app, just like any other application. But I think we've stopped pushing out the Taurus wallet like long ago.
Mm-hmm.
These are just like, I don't know. I don't know where they come from. But we have 200K, 300K once active users on Taurus. So we realized that retention didn't seem to be there, right? So what we did was we kind of, like, in 2020 or 2021.
Whoa, shit, dude.
Nearly fell and died. dude, it's the other side.
Whoa.
You have died.
Oh, dude.
That's deep.
So you had to pivot in
2020, we kind of pivoted into, a lot of people kept asking us like, hey, like we love it. We love the experience, but like we want to own the whole user experience ourselves. And we don't want it to deal with like the pop-ups. We want to kind of like build our own wallet. That's where kind of like we pivoted into, we launched our wallet as a service product.
Wow.
And that product became much more popular.
Yeah.
And people were paying for it. So we just full steam ahead, went down that direction. It very soon eclipsed like whatever users we were doing back then. And now we have maybe about, we launched some of the top wallets in the space, like Trust Wallet. We just launched a safe. That was just launched at DevConnect
like 2 days ago.
Congratulations.
And a Mocha Brands.
Okay.
Yeah, Mocha ID wallet. I'm not sure if you know Sequence. Skyweaver Sequence on Polygon.
It sounds familiar.
It's one of the wallets, one of the most popular wallets basically on Polygon.
Uh-huh.
That's also powered by us. ZeroDev, which is the most popular construction SDK, uses us as well. Along with Safe Wallet, it's like, you know, Safe Core SDK. What else? Let's see. So we have about maybe now at peak, we have about 12 million users a month
mm-hmm.
on all of these different applications logging in. Now we have about 10.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And it still has social login at its core.
So the tech has evolved
mm-hmm.
as tech requirements evolve.
Uh-huh.
Back then, it just used to be social logins behind a DKG. But then we realized that people wanted kind of a little bit more device-based control and device-based management of their key. They were okay with it initially, but they wanted more security as time went on, right? So now we have kind of like an MPC setup that does like two of three.
Okay.
Right? And also even more recently, in the last kind of like 8 months, we've also integrated AA into different aspects of our stack.
Mm.
So now there's also a construction built on top of it. You can deploy with like, you know, Safe AA Core SDK, ZeroDev, Unipass, any one of their SDKs, you can actually take Web3Auth, plug it in particular, and then extend your stack to whatever AA setup that you'd like to set up to. So that has evolved over the years according to customer demands.
Mm.
I think ultimately it will continue to evolve. I think a big thing about authentication is that everybody wants it slightly differently, an identity, right? Mm-hmm. And they have custom needs, different stacks. Like gaming applications want to do it on Unity. What? What's up?
You just jumped.
Mm. Oh, don't worry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
So different people want like Unity and different stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's more or less how we just listen to the customer and just build more or less.
Yeah.
What are you hearing from the customer nowadays about, you know, they said, oh, we want a more integrated experience. You said, okay, here we'll take Taurus, which does iframe and it's almost like a managed service. We'll give you Web3Auth. And they said they want more security, so you switch from the distributed key generation to more of an MPC style format.
Yeah.
So there's been technical evolutions from the beginning stages in 2019 to
and
DKG and NPC, are those two separate forms of key generation and private key storage?
So NPC is, they're all different forms of manipulating your EOA, which is your externally owned account, which is just words for a public private key pair. A cryptographic private property keeper. They're different,
mm-hmm.
but in the similar field of cryptography.
Okay.
MPC is a very large umbrella term, actually. And before crypto became its number one use case,
mm-hmm.
MPC has been researched for like 20 over years, in particular by old cryptographers. And it used to refer to privacy use cases more. Privacy was one of its biggest use cases. What MPC stands for is multi-party computation, which is splitting up computation to be done on different instances,
mm-hmm.
such that these instances protect a particular secret most of the time. Now, when using MPC for key management, right, you are basically that secret that you're managing is a user's public private key pair or a user's EOA. So MPC basically splits the user's public private key pair up into multiple different parts. And then you use these different parts in kind of like a threshold manner, just like a multi-sig, to basically sign and secure a user's public private key pair. Now you might immediately ask me, wait, Zhen, like, why not just use a multi-sig? That sounds like a multi-sig.
Right, two of three, two of four, yes. You take the keys, you sign, and then it executes.
That's exactly it, right? So it does exactly sound like a multisig, right? And you can do three or four or five or four or four or six or whatever.
Split keys up and
yeah.
And
Yeah. It keeps going on, right? So you might go like, hey, like why isn't this a multisig? Right. So the main reason why MPC became MPC is actually the de facto enterprise standard for managing public private key pairs. Like, are you familiar with like Fireblocks? Are you familiar with like, so and these companies all like if you're an exchange like Binance, Binance uses MPC internally to secure their assets.
They're
internally.
Their hot wallet,
cold wallets, all of them, all use MPC. And this is the same for Coinbase. It's the same for a lot of your venture funds out there, all use MPC. And the main reason why MPC has won over the multi-sigs in the enterprise space is because MPC allows you. The interface for MPC is a public private key pair, which essentially allows you to interact with any chain. With a multi-sig, you have to deploy it, and you can only interact with one chain.
Is this because it's a smart contract?
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. Multi-sigs are smart contracts, and they're specific to chains.
Okay.
Whereas MPC is not specific to chains and on like any chain, and because of that as well. Because it's off chain, it doesn't cost any money. Like on Ethereum today, if you deploy a Gnosis safe, that's gonna cost you $50 to $60. That's the same with a little bit cheaper with any AASDK today. Like use a construction on mainnet, that's what you're paying to deploy it, right? Like these, companies didn't want it to pay. Companies don't want it to go through a hassle. That's in one chain, right? And like some chains don't support multi-sigs, some chains are non-EVM, some chains are EVM. People didn't want to deal with any of that. People just wanted, So MPC
is a universal solution that can apply across whichever chain.
Yeah. So MPC had become the de facto kind of solution for enterprise. And we thought that, hey, let's democratize MPC such that any user can use that as they want to. And today, that's what you get with, let's say, any wallet that integrates Web3Auth. You get MPC out of the rack, right? Out of the box.
Okay.
It's
almost wallet as a service, right, is very understandable, easy to understand. Underneath the hood, it is MPC as a service. Is that correct?
It is MPC as a service as one of the multiple services that could provide you a wallet function.
Okay.
Because we also have AA under the hood as well, account structure.
And how is this where social login is a layer on top of MPC?
So social login controls and manages the EOA to essentially a account structure wallet. So MPC is more of like one of the technologies, MPC as a service.
Okay.
So the ecosystem has evolved. Now it's AA, but previously the RAID used to be MPC. Like a year and a half ago, or like 2 years ago, it was like, oh wow, everybody needs MPC. Now it's AA, account abstraction. So now everybody's integrated in account abstraction.
Yeah, that is the new narrative.
It is.
And in these formats, whether it's DKG or it's account abstraction or it's MPC, whichever whichever format of key generation is used, is there, you know, the saying is not your keys, not your coins, right?
Yes.
So when Web3Auth generates a private key, public key pair, is Web3Auth or is one single entity holding the keys, or are the in whichever key generation process,
yes,
these keys are distributed across multiple parties?
So we're a non-custodial solution, which means that our definition of non-custodial is one property that is very strong, and then the second property that is more loosely applied.
Yeah.
The first property is that nobody but the user has access to their private key pair. The second property is nobody can deny access to a user's private key
pair.
And is it the user's choice?
And so our default setup on Web3Auth, right, is it starts with a two of two. So think of a multisig, a two of two multisig.
Okay.
In particular. And this two of two multisig is between yourself on your device most of the time, as well as one on Web3Auth, which is managed by your Google login.
Okay.
And now,
go ahead.
This Web3Auth segment, actually, you ask first.
When the Google account manages the second key pair,
yeah,
how does it do that?
So, we actually take. So that's where the DKG comes in.
The DKG.
The DKG. So we take this. Think of it as two parts.
Uh huh.
Right, one key split into two parts.
Okay.
One of the parts lives on your device.
Uh huh.
The second part is split into yet another five parts.
Okay.
We call these parts shares.
So now we have six parts.
So now we have six parts, but we have six parts, mm-hmm. but five of the parts constitute one part
of the pair.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
So think of it as two of two.
Uh huh.
And then one of the two of two is split into three of five.
Okay. Okay.
And that's and this needs five, right?
Mm-hmm.
It can be three out of five, five out of nine, but we have different constructs for different customers.
Mm-hmm.
It's run by large ecosystem stakeholders. So Web3Auth runs one, Polygon runs one,
mm-hmm.
Ethereum name service runs another.
Mm-hmm.
And is this Polygon running one of the five or one of the nine for everyone, or is it only for Polygon's implementation?
It depends on what you select.
Okay.
As a developer, developers choose what they want their setups to be.
Uh-huh.
At the end of the day, so we've had some people just want to run it entirely themselves completely. This 3 out of 5. Now you might ask, hey, if it's 3 out of 5, why don't just you run one? Right.
Mm-hmm.
Like why? If you're running all five, why not just run one?
If I'm in control of all five and I choose that, now there is benefit in large key stakeholders doing one of the five.
Exactly. So even internal companies have different teams,
mm-hmm.
different IAM setups. That's why Binance uses MPC internally,
mm-hmm.
right, in particular, because then they can ensure that it's split amongst a certain different demographic
okay.
artists and not just, you know, in big companies, you get people who just take it and run,
mm-hmm.
like, right? Like you can't have that happen.
Right.
Right. So some large enterprise customers definitely go for like these setups, just internal,
mm-hmm.
just to kind of like secure themselves,
mm-hmm.
send themselves almost.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The
infighting.
The yeah.
Internal conflict. Yes.
Like not so much conflict, but you know, manage. But, or
whether intentional or unintentional operational obscurities that could lead someone or a number of these signers to intentionally act against the company's interests or in their own self-interest.
So think of it as a safe.
Mm-hmm.
No, like a safe to, because this actually holds money at the end of the day. You steal this, you get one factor of a user's key.
Mm-hmm.
And you can then potentially do things which get a second factor and kind of mm-hmm. like steal. Right? So this is money involved here. So this is actually just like, you know, think of yourself as a bank and like how many people have access to the SIP? How many people like, and the reason why it's not 5x5, it's 3x5 or 5x9 or whatever, is because you also need redundancy, right? If it's 5x5, any one of the actors can go, oh, I'm not signing. And there's nothing you can do. The money is stuck.
Yeah.
That gives this person full control over, like, you know, kind of like what. So yeah, that's the setup. And then users naturally can add more factors. Or developers can add more factors or give more factors to the end user. Really, this is a lot easier to show rather than to tell. If you guys try, if you try like app.tor.us, like Taurus wallet, or you can try like really just any Web3Auth demo. If you log in and then you log in three times, right? We'll actually ask you to set up a third factor, which is then like Google login, but then the third factor is like, okay, you can do like authenticate.
Okay.
Or SMS or OTP.
Yeah.
Or you can do it with another social, or you can even use a password.
Okay.
Right. So like, ultimately it starts at 2 of 2, but then it goes into 2 of 3. And it's like the process that we like to, like, you know, we care about security a lot and we talk about it a lot. And it's because we know like the scams and the potential things that exist, and we keep hearing it when the crypto scene, right? Every other day, Binance just got hacked by 20 million, right?
Yeah.
Like every other day, somebody gets hacked, some entity gets hacked, money is stolen. So we know of the repercussions, but like this is not necessarily, not all users care this much. Actually, when you're talking about like applications that mostly use Web3Auth, they mostly use them for a better onboarding, a better user experience. So what that means is that these applications are like, you know, gaming.
Yeah.
Maybe yes, you have an NFT. But just one, you know, like you're maybe on like a donation app, like Good Dollar, or you're in a social app, right? You're just looking to tweet with your friends. You initially, as a user, most of the time when you first log in, don't care. You care, you care nothing about your account, actually. You don't care if you lose your account. If you lose your account, you wouldn't be sad at all. This goes all the way up to maybe $100 even for somebody who, depending on the person,
net worth,
and you know what they're used to,
The amount of value that they associate with the account starts off very low.
Yeah,
and grows with the amount of money or time
exactly
spend in this application.
Exactly. So what we have is we entirely always draw a chart, and we basically go like, when is that point when a user should be setting up 2 or 3?
Okay.
When is the user should be setting up more than 2 or 3? In particular, although most of our users are just comfortable 2 or 3, to be honest, and as a good level of security. But yeah, so it's kind of like an incremental or progressive both security as well as self-custody. Because, you know, in a 2 of 2 scheme, right? Remember I talked about the two properties of self-custody?
Yes. You said one of them is not being able to, no one can cut you off from your keys.
Yeah,
that was the second one.
That was the second one. The first one is no one can access your keys.
Okay.
Right. So with the first one, right, like that's true in the 2 of 2, right?
No one can access your keys.
Because a third party only has access to at most one factor.
Right.
Oh, you have the second factor.
Yes.
But because they can deny your signature for your first factor, the second property isn't necessarily true.
Yeah.
Right. So the second property only becomes true once you have 2 or 3 and you're managing factors outside of this third party.
As long as you...
Never.
Yeah, you manage 2 of those 3 and the other person... So in this setup, if it's 2 of 3, maybe I have one key stored locally on my machine.
Yep.
Another, let's say Google, or some social login has another form of key.
Yep.
And the third one is my two-factor authentication.
Yep.
So then when I sign into Google, that unlocks one of those keys. And then I have to either
be on an existing device.
Be on the device or have the two-factor.
Yes.
But Google on their own cannot access my account.
Yes.
They can also not shut me off because I have the other two keys.
Yes. 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 So incremental security, incremental self-custody. As and when the user requires it. Yeah, and that's basically the setup that we try to push out.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has their own edited version of this sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Some people prefer to be custodial first and shift into non-custody afterwards. Okay. Some people prefer to, like, so they just do one of one initially, right, for example. Some people prefer to just start off with two or three right off the bat and even increment it depending on their use case, right? So it really just depends. Like a financial app, like, you know, like who's issuing like an ETF will start everybody at 203 and require 203 off the bat.
Okay.
But like a gaming application may start off 1-on-1 first and then shift to 202 and 203.
Okay.
And
that this was a like amazing like construction of like security application. So I'm thinking like now theoretically like what does this unlock? Like and maybe a little bit more practically, like, what are you seeing in data and like empirically? What are your partners telling you? Who are you seeing adopt? Like, what are you most excited about in kind of the next,
right?
Like going forward.
So when it comes to current adoption, right? It's actually quite split between different industries. We have like 20%, like on NFTs, 20% on gaming, 20% on DeFi or payments, and then a whole section of others. Like,
starts to head back. Or maybe we go around.
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
So it's quite distributed across different, I would say, industries. I think one thing that aligns people is that they want to own the whole user experience, or they want to, you know, target mainstream users, onboard like millions or billions of users, blah, 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 blah. I can't tell you the number of times the app has told me, bro, I'm going to onboard 20 million users for you. And then they launch as like 200K. So currently, it's quite even. I think what I'm most excited about, we started to try to think about not just like providing wallets to users, but also allowing, you know, we have 10 million users. That's a lot of users in particular. It's like somehow more than the whole crypto, like maybe not whole crypto, but it's like matching that in a way. It's because not all of our users transact.
Okay.
Right? Like a lot of the applications, they don't necessarily always transact.
Maybe they connect with Google and they don't do anything.
Maybe they connect to Google and they have an address and sometimes they send an NFT, sometimes they do whatever. So this is wild cards. One of the really, really OG people who enabled donations on chain.
Ooh, very cool.
In particular, and they allowed you to buy animals. Not buy them, but like
NFT.
Like buy NFTs that represented taking care of animals.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Have you heard of Harbor Attacks, maybe?
Oh, Harbor Attacks, no.
It's a token that's always for sale. But it's a token that always has a price.
Okay.
When you purchase it, you choose the price. And then hard coded in each NFT is a fixed percentage. So, like, let's say one NFT is 10% per month. So if you set the price to
100%.
No, if you set the price to $100.
Okay.
Then you would pay $10 per month to the organization that's doing research or protecting the animals. That was the basic idea.
It was fun. Is it still going?
Yeah, it's all on chain. I haven't worked on it for many years.
Was one of the core OG projects. Do you guys use Taurus Wallet or Web3Auth?
Yeah.
Do you guys use Taurus Wallet?
At the time, it was Taurus.
See? Back in the day? Yeah. So.
Be that OG, man.
No, man. I think they're there.
Okay. Just, Awesome.
Very cool. Wow. So, and this enables maybe it was zoos or pet owners or humane societies to accept donations.
Yeah,
and in crypto. Is that right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm South African. There's a lot of like wildlife conservation organizations.
Uh-huh.
So that's where it started. So I had friends in that sort of space.
Right now, you can buy a license to kill a rhinos.
They
say it's conservation, but
yeah.
When I was, sorry, please go ahead.
Yeah, I do not support killing rhinos.
Yeah.
And yourself, what do you have?
We're recording an interview, but this is a great use case. Like, this is a very practical
use case.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's really cool that you came in. I do education, so I'll have to try to put things in simple terms for people to understand.
Oh, cool. So where would I get this interview?
The roll-up. Yeah, .co, the roll-up company.